to give you a countdown from 10. All right, good evening, everyone. Welcome back to the Vancouver Aquarium, our introduction to marine life course. My name is Jonathan. Tonight's program, pinnipeds. And in case you were wondering what those are, you will know what they are by the end of tonight. Our instructor is a research associate at the Vancouver Aquarium, a professor at the UBC Fisheries Center, and director of the UBC Marine Mammal Research Unit. He studied mathematics, ecology, and zoology. His research focuses on Steller sea lions, northern fur seals, and harbor seals. I guess I gave away the answer to the pinnipeds, if you were paying attention. His research involves doing captive studies, field studies, and simulation models that range from single species to whole ecosystems. He's dedicated to furthering the conservation and understanding of marine mammals and resolving conflicts between people and marine mammals. A few years ago, I had an opportunity to see firsthand how dedicated our speaker tonight is at ocean conservation and connecting people to animals. He's studying fur seals here at the Vancouver Aquarium, and he has them here. And he brought a group of school children from the Pribilof Islands, where the seals were from. And he brought them down here so that the students, the children, could see how well the fur seals are being cared for, and they could meet them and see the work that they were doing. And then after that, he also did a number of kind of extended or long distance learning classes with those students while they were back home with the scientists and other educators that were here back at the aquarium and in Vancouver. So there is a lot of dedication in this individual, and it's my pleasure to welcome Dr. Andrew Trites. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Jonathan. So tonight we're going to talk about the fin-footed creatures, the pinnipeds of the world's oceans. And those of you that have been here at the aquarium, of course, are familiar with two of the families. We have our phocids, the true seals. You've all seen the harbor seals. I'm sure even if you haven't seen them at the aquarium, you've seen them along the beaches in Vancouver. We have the other family, a second family, the Otariids, the sea lions, and we have Steller sea lions here. And the one you may not have seen before would be walruses, the third family, the Otobenidae. We're going to, tonight, sort of talk about a number of different things. I want to just sort of very briefly start by just talking about what species are in Canada, what are these three families, how many different species are in them. I'm then going to talk about the basic life cycles of the pinnipeds because they differ from other species. They've got certain constraints. So we'll go through that and talk about when they arrived on land or ice, how they give birth, how they take care of their young, what's mating. I mean, every good lecture needs a little bit of sex in it. And so we'll show a little bit of that. We'll talk about molting, and some of us can relate to losing their hair. Seals lose all their hair every year, but fortunately they get to grow it back. And then we'll talk about migration and what it is to get out of town. That'll be the second part. I then want to give you a couple of case histories and focus on a bit more detail about harbor seals and Steller sea lions, two species we have here in British Columbia, and I think you might find it interesting to learn a little bit more about them, so the next time you do see them, you will know even more as you look at them. And finally, I will do pretty note-heavy at the end to do these comparisons between these three different families. What do they share in common, and what makes them different as well? How many of you are going to try to take really detailed notes? Okay, a few of you. So I don't want you to get frustrated in trying to copy everything down, because Jonathan has kindly offered to take notes for everybody. And before he gets on the mic, he said, no, that isn't quite what I said. He's going to ensure that copies of all the texts you see here that you'll get. So should you start writing and the slide moves too fast, you will be able to get it. And I'm assuming by tomorrow you'll have copies of all the words that are up here. You know, typically if it's just a public lecture, it'd be heavy with images, but this is a class. And what's a class without lots of notes? We're looking here at Pacific walrus. I did some research with colleagues up in the Bering Sea. And I think it's important when we talk about pinnipeds and marine mammals that you get to see a little bit about them moving and what they're doing. In this case, we're on an icebreaker. We're using a helicopter to land, and we're trying to attach tags to them. Now, you just saw a very quick clip of something going on there, and I'm not sure exactly what you may have all seen. So I'm going to play that again another time. First thing, we just talk about walrus, one thing. You notice how enormous their tusks are and how both males and females have tusks. Do you know what they use their tusks for? What would you assume? What did you see them trying to use in that picture? That's right. They're, you saw them trying to use their tusks to grab up onto the ice to pull themselves out, essentially to leverage in the way that you might use a climbing pick if you're mountain climbing to pull yourself up. How many people think they might use it to go to the bottom of the ocean and sort of hoe through the bottom to look for? No, they don't. They really are climbing tools. And when they go down to the bottom, they have incredible suction ability to go down essentially both by blowing out and sucking in will clear the mud to get extremely well-buried clams deep in the mud. They've got an amazing suction ability. In fact, one of my colleagues who works full time as a walrus says, one of the rules in the field is never French kiss a walrus. Okay, I'm going to play that again. One other thing to look for here on the far left, you'll see some really brown ice as I start this again. And that's when we're even looking for them. You can see when they haul out, they create enormous piles of waste. It all melts in and it turns the snow and ice very brown. Their bodies actually will warm out pools of water from the heat of their bodies. This is an area, it's a polynya, so it's pack ice all around, but this is one spot where the ice is broken, and they're coming in here, they feed underneath, and they haul out. So we're just going to back up, you're going to get to watch it. And of course, a lot of the noise here is the wind that you're hearing, and you can't really hear, they are quite vocal, it's kind of a woof, woof, woof sound, and it really is a beautiful, beautiful sound. So I'm going to back up and then jump into it one more time. So watch carefully. A little bit of dark brown on the far edge. This animal here is trying to pull himself up. You'll see them trying to put their tusk into the ice. Too soft, not strong enough. A little bit better. Whoops, broke. They are enormous. It's got to get into the really solid stuff to get out. Anyway, a little bit of walrus. Let's look at another species here. From the second family here, we're going to look at one of the otoriids. These are northern furs from the Pribilof Islands and up in the middle of the Bering Sea. And if you listen, you can hear the sounds of a barnyard. The clucking of chickens, the bleating of sheep, and every now and then there's that roar of a lion. We know that we have a big male. The males are four to six times bigger than the females. It's one of the biggest differences in the sizes of adult males and females. The little black animals are pups, and of course you're seeing so many more pups than adult females because their mothers are out at sea feeding for somewhere between 5 to maybe 10 days. They're looking for food and they'll come back and just spend a day and a half with their pups and then leave again. When the females get back, they're exhausted, they're dissolved. You see the sleep. Some of these pups are with their mom and others are just looking. And this is just to remind everybody that it isn't a Garden of Eden out there. Some animals don't get back in good condition, and of course they serve food for other species, such as the seabirds there. Third species to watch a video of is the harbor seal. Do you want me to keep going? It's sort of curious, you know, we have these amazing wildlife documentaries on walrus and sea lions and fur seals. But who's ever done one on harbor seals? We sort of look at it as, for whatever reason, they don't get enough attention, yet they are a fascinating species. And I think after trying to look for some footage, and I've never shot any myself, thinking, you know, maybe there's a story here. But at the same time, the story could be a bit of a snoozer, too. So here we have our three families, the phocids, the true seals, and we split them into the southern ones and the northern ones, and roughly the same number, 10 phocids in the north, in the Arctic, and by the north, I'm also including the temperate areas as well, or north of the equator. And south of the equator, we've got 8 species. We'll talk in a minute about what some of these species are. The otariids break into sea lions and fur seals. And we've got 5 species of sea lions, 9 species of fur seals. Only one of these fur seal species is in the northern hemisphere. All the rest are in the southern hemisphere. And then the otobenids, only one species, although we recognize them as there being an Atlantic and a Pacific population. So with that, you realize that in the end, there aren't that many species, so it's quite easy to become an expert in it. You only have 33 to learn things about. Whereas if it's on the cetaceans, there's more. So in Canada, we have 12 species. And for those of you with pen and paper, I wonder if you could quickly write down the 12 species of pinnipeds we have in Canada. It's not that many. And just see how many can get 12 on their list. And as you're thinking about it, I would also like you to think about, and for also those people that are online, as they're writing this down, think about whether or not of these 12, which ones breed in Canada and which ones just visit. So who are our true native animals and which ones are just passing through, taking advantage of Canadian hospitality? So as we think first here about the breeders, can somebody give me some names of species? We'll see how many we can get. Which animals are breeding in Canada? Which of the 12 that are in Canada, give me a couple that breed here. So harbor seals is a given. Steller sea lions, another one. Northern fur seals don't breed here. Harp seals, and now we got somebody thinking broader, going across to the other side of Canada. What else is with harp seals often? Walruses are going to be further north, so they're going to be in our list. At the back? Gray seals, that's another good one. I'm involved in meetings this week with people from Fisheries on the East Coast that are concerned about gray seals eating all their codfish. And we're discussing, I've got a student working on that right now. Other things? Other species? I think we only got about 6 so far. We have a ways to go. Ring seals, that's an excellent one from the Arctic. What are the ones in the Arctic? Ribbon seals aren't part of the Canadian fauna. They're on the U.S. side. I wish we had them. They're so beautiful. Somebody said elephant seals, but they don't technically breed here in Canada. They do visit, although at Race Rocks, there have been a couple pups born there, but it doesn't quite count yet as being a breeding population. And they breed Mexico and California. California sea lions, do they breed here? No. Only the Steller does. What are we missing? Okay, I won't hold the suspense. Let's have a look here in the list and see what's hasn't shown up here in the list. So we did get the walrus. We did get the... Oh, sorry, I did put ribbon seal on here. My apologies. Ring seal, bearded seals. And the bearded seal is, just as the namesake says, it's got a huge mustache. Hooded seals are often found with harp seals. Gray seals, harbor seals, and Steller sea lions. So good job on that. In terms of the ones that don't breed here but pass through, I think we've said it. We heard elephant seals. I heard California sea lions, northern fur seals, and I'm missing one. Just those 3. So those are the 12 that we have. And for these 3 here that are migrants, this is a pretty important feeding area. Increasingly for both northern elephant seals, northern fur seals as part of their migration, and California sea lion males as well. So on to life cycles. Showing here the calendar in the roundabout fashion. And with most species in the Northern Hemisphere, most are breeding sort of summertime, although we have the exceptions, those that are either using ice or, such as gray seals, that seem to have been related to ice species are breeding in around December, January. After animals are born, there's a period of mating. You then have this period here where the animals have to also molt and shed their old hair to put on new hair, because one of the ways that they're staying warm is both with their blubber as well as with hair as well. And so hair gets damaged, worn, broken, frayed ends, and as a result they shed. And then we have this long period here of seasonal fattening, in some cases lactation, providing milk to the pups. And we've got different periods of time here for lactation, depending on the species. So going through more detail, starting here first with this arrival on land or ice. I recently got involved with some information about archaeologists who claim that, once upon a time that seals gave birth in the ocean on beds of kelp. Does anybody think that would be possible? There's a reason why animals are so dependent on land or ice. The pups can't survive. The only of all the seal species, the harbor seal is the most precocious and can swim relatively early in life. But most of the others, they're going to drown. They can swim initially, and then they're going to die of hypothermia and eventually drown. So they're all dependent on giving birth on solid substrates. And we've heard occasionally some years where animals can't get ashore properly, and they will give birth in the water if it comes down to that, but their young are not going to survive. Typical pattern is that males will arrive before females, on average, trying to stake out their territory. And some species fight very actively, while others may just protect a little bit more passively in the water in a slightly different way, but still essentially establishing their presence to deter other males from getting access to females. For the most part, it appears that hauling out on land does stimulate birth once you get up to that prime period when a pup should normally be born. A lot of people say, well, is it possible to have twins? And the reality is that the animals only have single pups. They've got two uterine horns, and it goes back and forth between years. And so they're only going to have one pup at a time. They don't have twins, they don't have triplets. Occasionally there's been reports of animals nursing two pups, but as near as we can make out, that's really been a case of an animal stealing another pup, or perhaps another pup that's lost his mother trying to get adopted. And while it is physically possible perhaps to occasionally even find an animal that has had two fetuses at the same time, the reality is that the mother can't produce enough milk to grow her pup, so she would not be able to support having two pups. It seems to be whether or not the pup comes out head first or tail first may not seem like such a big deal, but I'm sure that people who have had babies think, well, this could be quite a big deal. And the reality is that for the seals, it's about 50-50. As they come out, the umbilical cord breaks, and the mothers typically are vocalizing. They'll turn around to see what is this new thing that just happened, and instinctively they usually pull it towards them. And they will spend time this initial period getting to know their pup. Pups vocalize. Some of them are extremely noisy. If any of you have been involved with the rehab program with the young seal pups, you've heard these mwa calls. And on the rookery that I was showing you with the northern fur seals, you could also hear a lot of those calls were females, or sorry, were pups that were calling. But after they wean, they typically all go quiet. And, suckling. The pups are going to nurse within hours of birth, and the milk that they're drinking, it's richer than whipping cream. And it's been very hard as people try to do rehab with seal pups trying to reproduce the same quality of milk that mothers produce. It's extremely high in fat, and the animals are going to need this high fat diet both to build fat layers as pups, as well as to start what they have to do, a very rapid period of growth to get up to a near adult size as quickly as they can. The suckling is going to be occurring on land or ice, and walruses, though, can nurse in the water. But the other species, all the nursing is happening either on land or on ice. The bouts, and people have sat there with stopwatches trying to record this. And I remember I had one of my graduate students was studying this with Steller sea lions with stopwatches. And lo and behold, he became a father, and didn't he bring out a stopwatch watching his own daughter? And his wife didn't think it was that she needed to be part of a biological study, but he just couldn't resist the urge to time it. 11 minutes for phocids on average, and maybe providing milk about every 3.5 hours. And with the otariids, around about 17 minutes has been suggested, about an average time of about every 3 hours. So I think the point here is that the nursing bouts are quite intense, and then a break, and come back, and quite intense again. And the animals literally do fill their stomachs to the point that some may even just vomit their milk too. But they're going to drink until they're satiated, the belly's full, digest it, and then nurse again. Teats, for those that are counting, the otariids or fur seals, sea lions, and the walrus have 4, and the phocids have 2. So the next time you see the seals out here or you see the sea lions, ask the trainers to determine so you can do your own count and see whether or not this holds up. And again, we have a couple of exceptions at the bottom of the monk seals and the bearded seals. Whoops. The lactation and the amount of time that a pup is going to receive milk varies depending on the species between 4 days to 4 years. And the species that does it the fastest in only 4 days, it is a Canadian species. And I mean, just remarkable, the pup is born, and then for 4 days, this pup is drinking. It almost, you watch like a balloon getting bigger as the pup is growing. Any idea which species that would be? What's your guess on that one? It's close to the harp seal, but it's not the harp seal. But it's another species that's often found on the ice with them. And the male, when he gets really excited, he blows his nose inside out, so it's nice, bright, and red. And that is the hooded seal. Were you going to say hooded seal? It is the hooded seal. And that's a remarkable species that can you imagine a mammal that only had to nurse your young for only 4 days? And then it can now be free living on its own. The milk is extremely rich, and the whole goal here is to grow the pups as fast as possible. For the otariids, the sea lions, and fur seals, it's longer. And so while for the phocids, I said the shortest is 4 days, but more typically it's several weeks. For the otariids, we're looking at several months to maybe up to 2 years, and even a bit longer for a few animals. So the difference is that the phocids grow very rapidly, and the otariids are going to grow more slowly. And the otobenids, the walrus, typically about 2 years, which would mean that mother's only going to have a calf. And we call, that's an interesting thing, we call the newborns for the otariids and the phocids pups. But what do we call the newborn of a walrus? We call it a calf. I don't know why, but that's the term that biologists are using. And of course, that would mean that mother would only have a calf every 2 years. Oops. Going on to attendance. So by attendance, I mean the amount of time that the female is going to be spending with her pup. Whoops, I'm going to back it up here. So initially, the pup is born, and the mother's going to spend, in the case of some species, probably about a week. We call that the perinatal period. And the mother's going to get to know her pup. She needs to know it because when she goes out to sea to feed, she comes back, she's going to see anywhere from tens to hundreds of other pups that to your eye or my eye look completely identical. And so how does she tell them apart? How does she find her own? Well, she learns first the smell of her pup. They all smell different. To my nose, they all smell the same. To mother, they know the smell of their own young, and they also have a unique voice. And so the imprint and the pup learns the voice of the mother. Mother learns the call of the pup. And so that's what's going to happen as they come back to shore. The female's gonna call, the pup will call back, the call, everyone's getting really excited, and mother gets up close and she smells, and she goes, that's not my pup. And then she will often grab the pup and throw it away, and then she'll start calling, looking for the real pup. So occasionally pups try to sneak, but the smell will always give them away. The phocids, so what I was describing there is essentially with sea lions and fur seals. And for the phocids, the tendency is that the females don't leave their pups. Harbor seals do leave their pups briefly, but they're never that far away. And that's why you often hear it said, if you find a pup on the beach, leave it there. The mother's probably very close by. It's rare for the phocids to leave their young for very long, if at all. The pups are solitary, although if you think back to, I haven't shown you, well, the first seal one you can see maybe some pups interacting. I'm going to show you a little bit later some footage of Steller sea lions, and you're going to see in there that some of the pups are fighting. And if you look carefully, get to know them, it turns out that when newborn pups are growing, the ones that are fighting, it's not the girls, it's the boys. And they're typically roughhousing, and they're learning the skills from a very young age they're going to need once they get into adulthood to fight for territories where the stakes are much higher. And for the phocids, and so here again we've got a difference where we've got for the phocids, the pups are being born essentially in isolation, so even though we have maybe on the big ice floes the harp seals and the hooded seals, they're not all next to each other. They're scattered all over. Harbor seals too, they can be, you know, to the log booms, you're not gonna find them side by side, mothers and pups. They're also scattered. Whereas with the fur seals and sea lions, they're all right together, shoulder to shoulder. The otariids, the pups sort of stay by themselves. Actually, they're staying with mother until she leaves on that first feeding trip. And after that, the pups are going to stay together. And can you think of a reason why, if you were a Steller sea lion pup, it might be a good idea to hang out with other pups instead of being off on your own? Yeah, it's safer. You saw how big those males are? Those males are storming about fighting. They're not watching that little guy. In fact, what are the odds that that guy is the father of the pup that's there? For the most part, the males are breeding with females. They're never going to know their pup. And the pups that are born are actually the offspring of other males. So if anything, they are stepfathers. And they're not, while they're quite gentle in terms of walking over, they're providing no care. Only the females are caring for the pups. So the pups then are going to gather in little pods, groups together, and they're going to interact with other pups. And the males are going to be much more active on here, essentially trying to fight off other males as well as to start breeding with females. And they will be sniffing females, trying to determine whether or not they are ready to be mated or not. At the end of this whole period of nursing, whether or not it's 4 days, 4 weeks, or a year or longer, the animals have to wean. And for the phocids, it tends to be very, very abrupt. And right after mother has left the pup there, you would think, well, maybe it's time for the pup to go in the water and start to feed on its own. Any idea what would happen if, when you put an elephant seal pup into the water right after mother has left? Or what happens to a harp seal pup you put in the water? Remember, this pup has been drinking so long, it's full of fat, and it's got lots of fat. Any thoughts of what happens if you put something really fat in the water? Does it sink or does it float? It floats. And essentially, it's like trying to push the cork of a bottle down. And they can't get down as hard as they try to swim. They're too fat. And of course, they stored up all this energy, which they're now going to convert into lean tissue as well, as energy as they're doing part of their growing. Until now, they have the right ratio of fat to lean tissue to now be able to dive and start to feed on their own. So in the beginning, they're not good swimmers because they're stuck on the surface. They're just too fat. The weaning period for most of the otariids is thought to be gradual, although even then we got some species like the northern fur seals where mothers can just leave after 4 months, or the pup may just leave and start to switch immediately. But for the most part, it seems that it's more gradual as the pups start still taking some milk but also starting to supplement with fish. We just did that. The matings and copulations. So for the phocids, that's at the end of the weaning period. And it kind of makes sense, right? That mother's not going to leave her pup until the pup is now able to live on its own. And the mother, and of course the phocids are quite fat typically, particularly for the females, they're going to use most of that energy that they've stored in their fat, convert that into milk. And once the pup is at the weaning size, it's going to leave, or the mother can leave, and the males will mate the females. For the otariids, it's somewhat of a similar strategy, that, except that in this case, for the first week on average, the female is only going to stay with her pup, and only at that point when she's ready to go on her first feeding trip, because the otariids don't have these thick fat layers, so they can't convert very much fat into milk. They have to go out and continually feed to take what the, essentially the fish that they're eating, convert that into milk. And so they have a very different strategy in terms of how they're going to produce the milk. And again, for the males, they don't want to let that female go away and come back, because she could be mated by another male in the water, she could walk through another male's territory. So the males are very protective to make sure they get to mate with the female that gave birth in their territories. The mating is usually on land, it's almost always there, but it can happen just in that nearshore area as well. We know for harbor seals, for example, the mating is occurring in the water, but for most of the species, mating is occurring land or right next to the birthing sites if it is in water. And here's a lot of interesting facts about how this all works, because, maybe before I give away the full punchline, we'll just think about here for a minute. They're going to be bred anyway, so essentially almost 12 months or maybe 11 months before they're going to give birth. And so, but for a seal, they don't, the growth of the fetus is only about 8.5 months long. So here's the conundrum. They're being bred, and about 12 months later, we're now going to see the pup being born, but the fetus only takes 8.5 months to grow. So there's a disconnect here. And what happens here is that the egg is fertilized, but it doesn't implant. And it just waits and waits and waits until about mid-November for some species, and then it implants, and then the fetus begins to grow. So we call that delayed implantation. And so it starts first with this fertilized egg, or the blastocyst, just this hollow ball of cells, and it's going to sit dormant for about 3.5 to 4 months. And then it'll move to one of these two uterine horns, essentially going to the opposite one that was used the year previous. And then it'll implant into the wall of the uterus and begin to develop. Nobody knows what the cue is for this. There's some suggestions maybe it's photoperiod or something else in the environment that signals the time to do it, but it happens like clockwork. And so now we've solved sort of two problems. The males and females only have to get together once a year, both to give birth and to be bred again. So it's quite an ingenious system that has evolved over time to make it work. Molting. So for the adults, and I've got a difference here with the pups, for the phocids, it's a very short period of time. The typical, for example, if you want to count harbor seals, you're going to find the greatest numbers on land hauled out when they're molting. They have to use extra body heat to come up to regenerate the hair and the new skin. And it's just easier to if you're going to expend that much of heat to stay on land as opposed to doing that in the water. For some species like elephant seals, we call that a catastrophic molt, and literally huge chunks of hair fall off the animal. We've had a few of these elephant seals hauling out in BC, some even around Vancouver, molting, and it looks as though the animal's sick. And because it's not going very far, they're staying on land, but big chunks of fur are falling off the animal. That's normal. That's how they lose their hairs in such a big patches. Whereas the otariids, and we've done some of this documenting here of the molt, it's almost like a sweater being unraveled, one line at a time coming down. And you can see the old fur, the different color, and the new fur right in behind. So a very different strategy in how they replace their hair. For the pups, they're born with a birth coat, which is different from what they're going to need once they're weaned, and they need to take on more of the adult type of fur. And so they've got a very different type of fur as a pup, which they will shed and replace with more of an adult type fur. And one of the exceptions down here, curious ones, is the harbor seal. Has anybody ever gone out and found a spot where you can find sometimes where harbor seals have given birth and you can find placentas from the harbor seals that gave birth? And should you be into this sort of thing and have a knife, cut it open and look inside, and you'll find often, in almost all of them, this matted silver hair. And that's because, essentially, it's a sort of fur that you would expect, or pellet you would expect to find for a harp seal that was born on the ice, this nice, white, fluffy fur. Every now and then, there's a seal that's brought into rehab that looks quite different than the others because it didn't shed this pup fur while it was still within the in utero. And it's kind of a strategy so that, and you think about it here where our seals give birth, for the fur seals or the sea lions, they're on these offshore rocks. There's almost no chance of any predator, terrestrial predator, getting to them. But for the harbor seals that give birth right along our shorelines, we've got cougars here, we've got bears, we've got wolves, and they're very vulnerable. So for a harbor seal, it means that getting rid of this pup coat and getting more of an adult type coat, they're much more precocious and they could slip into the water not long after birth and get away. So they've again solved a very tricky problem by shedding their pup fur just before they're born. So why do the pinnipeds haul out? Not just because they can. Can you think of some advantages for hauling out? So just shout out something. What's one reason? So if you were a seal, why would you haul out? Safety. What are you afraid of?
Orcas.
That's right. That's one thing you're afraid of. Anybody else have any other nightmares? What scares you?
Sharks.
That's right. So those are probably the two worst enemies of seals. Any other reason to haul out? You want to sleep. And again, sleeping, so you know when you fall asleep and you wake up, you know exactly where you are. You can fall asleep in the water and get washed and moved in different directions. So, and there's another element of safety in there too.
It can be warmer, I'm sure.
And it can be warmer too. Were you going to say that same answer?
Basically.
That's right.
Sunrise.
Yeah, because even though the animals are extremely well insulated, you're still going to save heat by hauling out. And you're going to lose a little bit of heat by being in the water. So yes, there is an energetic savings too. So I think you've hit all the major ones. Oh, and we already cost, of course, you already knew this first one. We've just been through it. They have to give birth on land. So they're required to do that. Thermoregulation, so the idea of staying warm. Predator avoidance. Oh, and we also have mate selection. It's a spot where if you come together, you're going to find everybody you know. And a place to shop around for mates. And there is a lot of competition for the males, as well as females checking out the guys, looking for the big Brutus types to father their pups. So that's during the breeding season. Other times of the year, we have, again, resting, sleeping, thermoregulation, the molting, the skin maintenance, and also predator avoidance. So there we've been through the essence here of life history, and been right here around the clock. So let's now move into a couple more specific examples of the pinniped life histories. And we'll start first here with the Steller sea lions and harbor seals. So in fact, I'm just going to come back to this other picture. So as you're looking at this, what do you see as you look at the picture? Any idea of the species we're seeing here in front?
Sea lions.
So there's sea lions. What type of sea lion? Okay, now someone said Stellars. Is that a guess or is that you know for sure? And this is something which I find a lot of people are confused. So first off, that was the right answer. But how do you know for sure? And one way here, you see this fella here, he's got this kind of a curved head. So it's a subadult male getting up almost to full-grown male size. But you see the skull is quite curved. If this was a California sea lion, the shape of its head would be nice and round like that. It's actually more like a box. They have this really steep sagittal crest, and so that's one of the clues is to look at the shape of their skull and the male California sea lion. So next time you're out and you see one, look and see whether or not it's got a box-shaped head, almost like it's wearing a baseball cap, or if it's rounded. There would be another way to tell if you could hear them. And what would the sounds be? So, you know, it's funny. Anytime somebody wants to, for my benefit, imitate a seal, what do? They start barking. Well, almost none of the animals bark. The only one that does that I know of is the California sea lion. So if it barks incessantly and it's really annoying, it's probably from California. And if it, you can interpret that any way you would like to. And if it is roaring in a very noble way, like a lion should, you're dealing with the Steller sea lion. So pay attention again to the sounds as well as to the shapes of the skulls. You see a nice big guy up here, and this sort of approach here, the guy's got his head on, pushing this other animal, and it's pretty typical behavior too of males. This would have been taken just at the end of the breeding season. So males that weren't able to breed this year, but they're still roughhousing and kind of pushing each other around. In the background, what do you see? Yeah, they're harbor seals. And so this is a site, it's on the on Haida Gwaii, a place called Rose Spit. And it goes way, 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 way out. It's remarkable far it goes out. At the end, we have these big gravel bars. And we've got both harbor seals and Steller sea lions. Although what's most remarkable here is that all the Steller sea lions are huge males. And I only know two spots like that where it's like a bachelor party. And they're just all hanging out and roughhousing and having a good time. So in terms of abundance, we have a lot of harbor seals in BC. Although, of course, in terms of saying a lot, it's all kind of relative. Compared to the numbers of people we have in BC, there's not that many. But compared to the numbers of marine mammals, species, there's quite a few. And this is just a brief account here that seals were not always that popular. There was a lot of concern about competition with fisheries, particularly with salmon fisheries. And so we have a period of time from 1913 to 1964 where there is a bounty on the seals. And somewhere between 200,000 and 240,000 seals were killed over this time period. Later on, we got a period where they're hunted for pelts. And by 1970, the population is estimated to have only been about 10,000 seals throughout BC. We had the Canadian Fisheries Act, I think it was 1971 that came in. And the animals were effectively protected under the Fisheries Act. And you can see then the population growing in subsequent censuses from 10,000 to 85,000, 130, about 140,000. And here I'm talking BC-wide. And there was a survey done just this past year within the Strait of Georgia, so I don't know the numbers most recently. It would appear, though, that the population's either peaked and stabilized or may even have been reduced. So a couple of things here for us to talk about. The number one here is when they had this bounty, and I don't remember how much they were paying, but it was their per snout of animals turned in. But there was a lot of motivation to get it because it was good money. And of course, there were some people that respected and were shooting seals, but other people shot dogs and tried to turn it in, and other people took other wildlife to turn it in. But the people paying the bounties, they could tell whether or not the snout came from a seal or another animal. And they knew it by looking at the whiskers. So next time you get to look at the whiskers of a harbor seal or look at the whiskers of a sea lion, see if you can tell a difference. Because on the whiskers of the seals, it is spiraled. There's a ridge, and it's like the spiral ridge that goes along it, whereas the shape of the other whiskers on the sea lions is completely smooth. There's no ridge on it. And there have been some studies done by putting blindfolds on seals in tanks and having them follow objects that were moved through the water. And it appears then the animals can use their whiskers to sense disturbances in the water column so they can track down fish in darkness to figure out where that fish is by essentially feeling the disturbance in the water column caused by a moving fish through it. So that's the first interesting tidbit about the bounties. In terms of the increase in numbers, currently here in the Strait of Georgia, we have the world's highest density of harbor seals. And so some people say, well, that's great news. For others, you know, that are concerned about poor returns of Chinook salmon or coho salmon, it's not such good news because there's concern that maybe these high densities of seals are responsible for poor returns of salmon. A number of us think that there may be fewer harbor seals now in the Strait because the numbers grew and then stabilized. And we're thinking that because I'm not sure, how many of you have been out looking at killer whales or gone on a whale watching trip locally out of Victoria or out of Vancouver? Anybody done that? So some of you have. If you've done it in the last couple of years, do you recall what type of killer whales you were seeing? So it used to be people going out there were seeing southern resident whales. In the last few years, the southern residents have not been showing up as they normally did. And the whale watching boats are seeing another type of killer whale almost on a daily basis. So those are the transients. And I'm not sure on your trips whether or not you were seeing transients or not, but I almost guarantee that if you go out now on a trip, you're going to find you're going to be out watching transients that are either just sort of moving slowly or perhaps even hunting. And we think that the transients sort of have only recently, perhaps in the last 10 years, discovered the world's highest density of seals. And literally, it's like gigantic sausages floating out here, just full of fat and everything to keep a killer whale happy. And so I'm really curious to see what these new census counts will show, because it would appear, at least our gut feeling is, that numbers may have declined, probably because of these top predators that are preying on the seals and keeping the numbers down. You've had a lecture, I think, on killer whales, perhaps?
Yeah.
And to recall what you were told about their number one preferred prey item? Anybody recall? So I'm going to assume it's going to be harbor seals. And again, there's just so much fat on them. So harbor seals is a preferred prey species for the transient killer whales. Hollowed sites. There's been a lot of research done trying to understand under what conditions do the harbor seals haul out. And it's been learned that they haul out, depends in essence on how high the tide is. There's more seals hauled out on a low tide than on a high tide. That makes sense because you notice that they're not really good at walking on land. They kind of hump along about the best they can do. So they're not great at walking or climbing. And so they are quite dependent on tide. Air temperature is quite important. I think someone back here talked about how nice it is to bake in the sun. And we see the same thing, that harbor seals tend to haul out higher numbers midday if the tides are right, or they could use a log boom where they're not restricted. And they do indeed like to just bake in the sun. Wind and precipitation, they hate wind and they hate driving rain. I think it messes with their hearing, with their eyesight. And why would you want to be afraid if you can't really hear or see properly? Because there might be a cougar, there might be a wolf. And certainly we find in BC evidence in the scats of wolves and cougars, evidence that they are eating seals. And so they have to be vigilant against that. Any idea why a biologist would be even trying to figure out what influences the numbers of animals hauled out? Outside of biologists ask strange questions sometimes, and they're always thinking about something else I could do that no one else has done. Is there a practical application for knowing this information? So just someone give me an idea. I can't quite hear up here.
Numbers.
Say it again.
Counting.
Counting, exactly. And so you think about counting, that I could tell you how many seals are hauled out here, but what we really want to know is not how many are hauled out, but how many are in the population altogether. So two things is, if you're going to time when you're going to go fly and count, are you going to fly in a high tide, in a heavy, high tide with, I don't know, no sun, no light, whatever? And of course, you're going to then think about the conditions. So you're going to try to time your flights to correspond with low tides and optimum conditions to get animals hauled out. And what's been learned is that about at any time here, we can find about 35 to 60% of the total population is hauled out during a count. And then we can put in a correction factor depending on what time was that count made, what were the other conditions, so each site could be given a separate correction factor to determine the probability of animals not being on land at that time. And as we talked about, midday peak or early afternoon is pretty common for being hauled out. Great time. And as we also talked about, we want to be able to use this to correct the estimates for the proportion at sea. So it means that on average, and I said there is a range depending on the actual conditions, but as a rule of thumb, the seals are spending about two-thirds of their time in water. And so you could think about it, for each seal you see this on land, there's probably two more in the water. And so if you want to do a count, multiply by three, and that's probably not a bad estimate of what the population consists of. How many have been able to get really close to observe harbor seals? Anybody get really close? You've been close. Where have you been close to seals before? Yeah, so you're seeing some of the log booms, and that is one spot where you can see them pretty regularly. And about the only reason why they're pretty common is because they are disturbed almost in the same manner repeatedly, so they have habituated. I know one case we're doing a study where also with log booms, and there was one of these small little tugs that pulls the booms, and that guy could bring his tug in smelling, belching gases, noisy, bang into logs. He would jump off, run around the seals, and go back onto his boat and do whatever he did. The seals didn't move at all. And then I watched as some guy in his canoe just came by gently, silently, and every seal cleared. And it's sort of interesting that if it's repeated in a consistent manner, then the animals do habituate. But if it comes out of blue and is something different, they will literally freak out. Have any of you been listening to the news about the walruses in Alaska? And how there's some sites with tens of thousands of walruses that are hauled out. It made the news, the rounds, just a few weeks ago. And what's happening there is that with less ice, and you saw those walruses trying to climb out on that thin ice, it kept breaking through, it needed that really thick ice. Well, now there's big stretches of the coast where there is no ice strong enough to hold the walruses. So they've begun hauling out on land, but they're hauling out in literally thousands together. They're so big that if they get startled and scared, they stampede and they're crushing and killing their young as they're trying to, in this panic, to get into the water. And it's been interesting to look, and I was at meetings last week, looking at some footage of this, and also people have set up cameras trying to understand why is this happening. And because we've seen cases here where animals have habituated, but the key is here it's repeated disturbances. There, they've got planes that are flying overhead and landing in hopes of finding ivory. And of course, just the plane flying overhead, because it's not a regular thing, the sound of that low-flying plane causes disturbances. They stampede, they crush, and sure enough, when they land, they're finding ivory that they can now take off of the dead animals. So there is problems going on, and the walruses don't have enough regular disturbance to ever get used to it. And it appears that we're going to be saving walruses now without sea ice. They're going to have to ban the flying of aircraft because they're growing. They live in an environment that is essentially completely silent, and they're so easily scared. And this is sort of interesting here too. I put the question, under what conditions do hollowouts form? For the walruses, it turns out that even having a dead walrus, so when these disturbances have occurred, the animals are gone, and then it takes many, many, many days for the animals to come back again. But what the biologists have observed there, too, is that if there is a dead walrus, often other animals will come back ashore and sit next to it, not knowing that it's dead, thinking it's sleeping, perhaps. And I did a similar study, and I didn't kill any animals, but I worked at the time with some of the artists here at the aquarium, and they were into it, and they built me three decoy harbor seals. That looked so lifelike, and I was sort of curious to know under what conditions would they haul out. So I went to a log boom, because that's not tidally restricted. If I was doing the water, I'd have to like nail it to the bottom of the ocean and then come back for it. But here in the log booms, I was able to create new haul outs. And so it appears then that the animals want to be near other animals because it's safe. And you see an animal sleeping there, it didn't die. It's still alive, and so it's safe, because initially when these hollows form, animals will come up, rest, and then slip back in the water. And it takes a period of time before you get a couple of animals hauled out together, and now they have the confidence that it's going to be a safe place to be, particularly for harbor seals. Just a couple of images here. So in this case here, I just want you to look at the color of the pelage, so the color of the fur, and compare it to the color of the rocks. And do you notice how similar the colors are and how well camouflaged the animal is? Let's look at another picture. Fits in fairly nicely. Another picture here, some up in the black, very dark kelp. And in BC, we have a few animals that are really white or quite white, but for the most part, our animals tend to be quite dark colored. And can you think of a reason what would be creating this selective pressure in terms of why you might end? So you might have initially started out with a mixture of all kind of color forms, white through to dark black, but we see predominantly these darker ones. And the reason is you're camouflaging yourself against killer whales, those transient killer whales that will be looking, and we know that the killer whales do spy hop, look, and they know the sites to check out as well. Pupping, this is sort of interesting with the animals. So here we've got them having, again, just a single pup, and it's about 6 kilograms, whereas the mother's about 65 kilograms on average. So they're a pretty hefty pup, particularly when you put that into human terms. We talked about earlier how this lanugo is shed in utero. So lanugo is what we call the fur, that silvery fur. And also, if any of you do get to go to the rehab site, you're too late for this year, but if you get in there, just see, you know, find out how often do they see these pups with their birth coats. And it's really quite a fascinating thing to see, the silvery gray coat that's a carryover, we presume, for when the species evolved from breeding on ice. In the Strait of Georgia, the animals are giving birth somewhere sort of July into early September. But elsewhere in the range, they're giving birth about 1 to 2 months earlier. And this has been a really strange thing that we see. So the Puget Sound, Strait of Georgia, Wanda-Fuca Strait, what we call the Salish Sea, they seem to have this difference in timing of birth. And it's really been quite puzzling about why that would be. We can't think of any selective reason in terms of predation that could have caused this to happen. And I'm going to come to the minute here. The final point here is this call that the pups make, you know, mwah, and it just blood-curdling sometimes, and it can be heard so far out to sea. I'm going to come back here, maybe in the next slide, yes, and this one here, and just talk about for a minute why we see this difference. I had one of my first graduate students looked at the genetics. We got tissue samples from harbor seals in different parts from BC, as well as I think we got some out of Alaska as well. And what we discovered is that we effectively have 2 different types of harbor seals in BC. It's still the same species, but one of this, the very first group, appears to have come from the Atlantic Ocean about 670,000 years ago. Glaciation came in, sealed off the Arctic Ocean, and then we had a second invasion of seals from the Atlantic Ocean. And so what we're suggesting in this paper we put out is that the North Pacific was colonized twice, essentially by Atlantic seals that got through the Arctic and came down. And, you know, essentially what we're going to be seeing too now with the deglaciation or the de-icing of the Arctic is probably also some transfer species back and forth through the open Arctic. So the only resident or residual population that's remained from this first invasion appears to be just here within the Salish Sea. So quite a unique one. There was also an indication that there were some of these same seals over in Japan, but they're all extinct now. Lactation, here we got a mother with her pup. Whoops. And in the Pacific, the pup will be suckling for about 5 to 6 weeks, but in the Atlantic, you see it's a much shorter period, only 3 to 4 weeks. Again, no explanation for why, but it's just different. Mating, the females come into estrus. Here we're just talking about harbor seals again, but the time of weaning, and the males are going to make these visual and auditory displays in the water. So on this, I was sent some audio tape from Haida Gwaii from the park, and they were essentially putting up recording devices to listen for birds. And they couldn't believe it that they were hearing gunshots going off. And so they're really puzzled because no one's supposed to be shooting guns in a national park. And I was really intrigued by it, and so they sent me a copy of their tape. And what they were hearing was harbor seals slapping the surface of the water. And I'm not sure if any of you have heard that, sort of think in the summertime, more into August, when pups are being weaned, and we're seeing this behavior. And so the males have essentially staked out territories. And the display they do is they will, on the surface, they will whip their bodies around, open that hind flipper up flat, and slap the surface of the water. It sends out a really loud sound. Animals on land can hear it. Animals underwater can hear it. And that's telling other males, oh, that guy that slapped either is really big or is kind of wimpy. I can take him. But it's essentially a signal that's being sent out. So if you are out in the water that time of the year on a quiet night, just listen for the sounds of gunshots. And I guarantee what you're hearing are males displaying to females. And these males, of course, are very vigilant. They're keeping track of where the females are with their pups, knowing that at the time of weaning, the females will be receptive. They're going to come into estrus. And they're also vigilant to other males that may be encroaching on them as well. These numbers for harbor seals, the biggest haulouts are occurring in the fall, and they're going to be hauling out here as they're molting. It's also one of the best times to get pictures of them because brand new fur really does shine, and it's not dirty, and it looks so much nicer, so freshly molted. In this case here, this animal here is not molted in this picture, but you can see one thing. So we're seeing here one patch of fur, and we're seeing something that looks quite different. And what you're seeing here is dry fur and wet fur. So when the animal is dry, the fur is basically standing up. It's quite coarse, rough, but it's providing a layer of insulation. But if the animal was to go in the water and start swimming, essentially wearing astroturf on its body, it would have an incredibly tough time to swim. And so when the fur gets wet, it now lies flat against the body, and literally just like a layer of skin on the animal. One of the studies we did here at the aquarium was trying to, we have a big tank where we can exercise the animals, they swim against current, and we're trying to get their heart rate to increase. And the idea was that maybe we could measure heart rate in the wild of animals and measure their metabolism. And so the first idea we had to raise it was, let's put on diving belt weights onto the animals. And we had these huge weights, and we're just like dragging them out and then strapping them on. And we put the animals in, and their heart rate barely changed at all. I mean, my heart rate was way up. The students were up just lifting this stuff. And so putting weight on made really no difference. And then we had the idea, we just put on a very, very thin strip of astroturf around the animal, and the animal's heart rate shot right up. And what was creating was this drag. And the same thing is happening here. So drag, essentially, more turbulence around the water. It's not moving. It's now got so much resistance, it's got to fight its way to get through the water. So again, they have this wonderful property with their fur that when it gets wet, it lies flat, there's no drag. But otherwise, they'd be swimming with astroturf wrapped around themselves. Steller sea lions, let's see. At some point, we're gonna be taking a break. I'm just not sure what time that is. We've been about an hour so far.
Yeah, anytime you wanna take a break, again.
Should we just take a break at this point, let you stretch?
Yes.
And how long should we make the break for?
10 minutes.
10 minutes? Because now we're getting to my favorite animal.
So if you guys want, you can go out that door. We have some refreshments.
Okay, so welcome back. We're now moving to the life history of Steller sea lions. And oops. Sorry, I pushed the wrong button here. I've got a technical, Are you able to start it up again? On this slide right here.
This one?
Yeah. And coming down to, okay. So here we go. A little bit of Dutch humor. As you can read, the locations here is Professor Steller is giving a lecture here. But what he's showing on here is the distribution of Steller sea lions. It's interesting that if you look at the Atlantic Ocean, so from Nova Scotia, Newfoundland, Labrador, over to Norway, all of Europe, are there any sea lions? Any fur seals, any otoriids? There aren't any. Although I did get a report of a California sea lion being near Plymouth, England. And that was a real, so all of us here were scratching heads like, how did it get there? Did it swim through the Arctic? And the best guess is it was probably one of these zoos or traveling shows that released the animal in the Atlantic Ocean where there are no otoriids in the North Atlantic. So except for that one California sea lion. So here you're seeing the distribution here. I'll show you another image here with a bit more detail. Starting here off of California, which is the southernmost range. This is showing you breeding sites coming up. We've got British Columbia coming across the Gulf of Alaska through the Aleutians down Kamchatka to effectively northern Japan. And I'm not going to go into too many details about their population, well, biology of the dynamics, other than to point out that genetically there are two distinct populations. Everything over here has declined. They're listed as an endangered species in the United States. Most of these rookeries are almost completely barren now. At the same time they've declined, the animals on this side have all been increasing. And so in BC, they're growing exponentially at extremely rapid rates and even starting new populations. So a lot of our research that we're doing here at the Vancouver Aquarium is looking at some of the mechanisms that could explain why one group is doing so well while another group is doing quite poorly. And we think it has to do with the types of fish that they're eating and due to natural changes in the ecosystem that have changed the types of fish. These ones are eating primarily gadids, codfish, walleye pollock, and our animals in this region here are eating some of those species, but they're eating a lot more sardines, herring, sand lance, the dark oily fishes that are high in lipids. I'm going to show you here what it sounds like to be up close to sea lions. Research boat, the Star Quest. And this is one of the haul-out sites. So just have a look. They're scanning here for doing a count of animals. Look for any animals that might be entangled or animals that are branded. You see one great big bull there moving on the lower right. And a lot of animals, both big males and animals of the ages. That was a haul-out. And here we're looking at a rookery. You can see pups. Yes, there's roughhousing there. There's two pups in the front. We've got two males. We've got a big male in the water. A couple of adult females looking. Seeing the biologists on there. And this is pretty typical of the pups. While their mothers are away, they're spending time learning to swim and playing in these nearshore pools. And again, the roughhousing is 9 times out of 10 is going to be males and females. Noisy, isn't it? And that's pretty typical. Did you hear any barking? Every now and then we're out and we do hear barking, and then all of us are scanning saying, where is that Californian? It's somewhere in there. But yeah, there is no barking if it's all Stellars. So here's a photograph I've taken of one of the rookeries. They're surprisingly steep, unlike for a harbor seal hollow, which is going to be quite low and gravelly often. Here we've got some very steep rock. And as you're looking at it on here, I'm wondering, can you see any kind of structure? Do you see the bulls holding territories, the females, the pups? Let's see, I think I marked them on here. So right off there, I'm showing where three bulls are. Can everybody see those? And these bulls would have come on early in the season before any females were there. They would have had some really nasty fights. There would have been blood, skin torn, a lot of havoc, and eventually they settle down. The males typically are only breeding here for about 2 years is all they're going to get to do, although some of them, when they first start, they're going to haul out on the periphery, and over time they get to know each other. And while there are some big fights, there's typically gentleman agreements about where the boundaries lie, although every now and then there's an upstart that comes in that tries to take over. So there we have the males. They're going to be able to hold a harem where they can breed with females that choose to, choose to give birth in there. Where are we going here? So I'm showing you some of the pups. You see how tiny the pups are in comparison? And they're just essentially pitch black in color, and that's their birth coat color. And all the other animals you're seeing in there that are not black are going to be adult females. So very high proportion of adult females compared to bulls. And in this case here, the photo has been taken fairly early in the season. We're in this perinatal period where a lot of the females are staying with their pups before they start their feeding trips. A couple of females, and it's always interesting to watch as the females, they can walk around to get to their pups. They typically like to climb over other females and just have it out. And there's often a lot of what we call jowling, as the females open their mouths, checking each other's size out as they're going through to get to their pups or get back to the water. So that's at a rookery. We also have haulouts, and nearby all these major rookeries, we have the bachelor pads, and you can see big-looking males, but they're not bruisers. They don't have that full big chest weight it's going to take to hold a territory. But in a couple years' time, they will. So they're typically hauling out here, too. We have another type of haulout, which is in the summertime, because not all animals go back to breed at these rookeries. We've got other sites where we find big breeding bulls, no pups born, but the males are mating with, in essence, many of them are young females, first-time breeders, or females that were not pregnant and were not giving birth to a pup, but will the next year. And so there is another sort of breeding structure happening at what we consider to be non-breeding sites. So not all the males need to go back to the rookery to become a dad. They can do so without any young ones around them at the hollowed sites in the summertime. And here's a fairly typical hollowed site where, again, some of these males in the summer can be breeding, such as this fellow up at the top right. And you see on here, no pups, but you can see sort of youngish or smallish looking animals. So these are going to be animals that could be 2, 3, 4, 5 years old. And many of them will be first-time breeders if they're young females. We got our bulls and some of the, what I'm calling here, yearlings or young of the previous year. And some adult females in amongst the bunch. Whoops. So the typical breeding season for Steller sea lions is going to be in starting in May when the big males come ashore to fight for the territories. Along comes June, and now the females are coming ashore to give birth. And they'll be using these rookeries up until about August, which point they will begin to take their pups away. They'll call their pups into the water. Sometimes they will throw their pups in the water, sometimes carry them in their mouths, almost like a dog with a puppy, drag it in, and they will sometimes put their body between the pup and land to push it out into the ocean to the point that the pup will now follow mother, going to another site. Because there comes a point when there's no advantage to being here with the other animals, it's better to move away from the rookery and get to the hollowed sites. And one thing just to look at in this picture is just look how steep this is. And while you might think, well, that looks kind of steep, I can guarantee, I've been on shore in this site, it is incredibly steep. And I'm always amazed at how steep and the ability of the animals to climb. But I'm also amazed at the size of the waves on the open North Pacific Ocean that come into these sites as well, and how high up they can the waves crash in. So they do have to get quite high up out of the water. Bulls are the first to arrive. They fight for territories. And they're going to fast while they're on land for about 40 days. Occasionally, we do see some of the big bulls leaving for short periods and coming back, and they get their territory back. But it's, again, back to the fact that they know the other big males that are nearby them. But for the most part, they've got to bulk up to eat enough to hold and fast for 40 days. And it seems that on average, the male might get to breed for 2 years. But if he's successful, he's probably going to sire, who knows, 30 to maybe 60 pups. Seem to be advancing quickly here. Body size, see here in terms of length here, males at 3 meters, females shorter, and pups about half a meter. But the really big difference isn't the body length, it's that body weight. And the males are going to be 2 to 3 times heavier than the females. So they're really big. Birth, you got a mother here with a newborn pup. And she's holding a pup quite close to her. You can see a little bit of milk on the pup's lips in the front. Single pup, as all otoriids and pinnipeds do, mother producing milk. And here you can see an example as mom is pulling the pup up closer to it, grabbing it by that scruff of the neck. And the pup complaining bitterly about being mistreated. We have this perinatal period where the female will stay only with her pup for about 7 days, living off of her own reserves before she goes to sea to feed. And of course, just before she goes to sea, to feed, we've got mating occurring. And the males are constantly sniffing all the females that are coming and going, and they will prevent any female from leaving that's not been bred already. And in this case here, the females have to be able to essentially hold their own weight because of the huge size of these males. And the mating can go on for what seems like an eternity as well. And ultimately, the female has tried to bite the male and try to get him to get off of her. You notice the male here's got a lot of scars, and that did not come from the females. That would have come from other males as he was fighting to get this territory. We did some work where we were onshore darting some of these adult females to put satellite tracking tags on them. And I remember one of my first trips out a long time ago now, and I was told, well, you had to stay behind and protect this female from the males because she's still too dopey from the anesthesia. And if a male was to mount her, he'd suffocate her. So if you see any males come along, you stand up and you keep them away. Anyway, so now we do that with all the new students. You get to stand there and protect her. And again, I don't think a photo quite does it justice about how big they are. And maybe some of you remember when our last big male here was Tag, about how gigantic he was. So they really are huge. So this is happening about a week after birth. We talked about how the gestation period is 8.5 months and the magic thing about delayed implantation so they can be bred and give birth just at the right time. Foraging trips when they go to sea. And this is where we have a lot of the conflicts with humans and fisheries is because as we look here at the diet, I've got the names of species down here at the bottom. You can see that they like to eat many of the same species that people also like to eat. So herring and salmon and cod and rockfish, octopus, squid, pollock, which is the world's at times biggest fishery or second biggest fishery. And pollock is turned into surimi, the artificial crab, or into fish burgers and McDonald's and Burger King. And Atka mackerel, which is related to ling cod, it's a hexagrammid, and sold a lot in Asia. Probably about the only species on here that people are not catching in North America are the sand lance, which in Europe is a very important fishery, and they refer to the species there as sand eel. But in North America, no one is catching this, and it's a critically important species for marine mammals as well as for seabirds. So just above that, I put the length of the foraging trips. Summer, they're fairly short trips, initially about half a day, and as the pup's getting bigger, extended to about 2 days in length. And as we get into the winter time, the pup, or now juvenile, could be left for anywhere from 1 to 4 days before the mother comes back to deliver milk. And it's quite, gee, I seem to be jumping a lot with these. Let me come back here. We've got here with the foraging trips, it's quite remarkable the fact that the mothers are able to find their pups again. that they don't get lost. And they, even though mothers are often moving with their juveniles to different sites, they don't always stay at the same one. But this ability to coordinate, because the animals will stay with their mothers anywhere from 1 year to maybe 2 or 3 years. And they have this remarkable plasticity or flexibility in the time at which the animals are going to be weaned. Sea lions are going to travel much further than the harbor seals. They don't migrate, but they've got bigger seasonal movements. They tend to prefer the coastal shelf in fairly close to shore, less than 45 kilometers, although they can be found over deep water. But the one thing we've learned about them, both from tracking them at sea as well as from the work we've done at our open water research station, is that they're lousy divers. They really aren't built to dive very long. And often ask people, you know, how long do you think a sea lion can dive for on average? And I get lots of estimates, you know, 15 minutes, 20 minutes. Do you want to give a guess at it? How many? 20 minutes. And that's a pretty common guess, but it's wrong. The answer is actually right here. This is what we found. Can you read that? 3 minutes. And I'm sure somebody's saying, you know, I could probably hold my breath for 3 minutes. And so this is what we call aerobic diving. So essentially it's the idea of repeatedly doing over and over and over again without having to rest or stop because you've now done it anaerobically and have to recover from it. And so it seems that the animals are not great divers and are built to do repeatedly relatively shallow, short dives. Coming back and finding their pups, you see in the background here, mother coming on shore, calling, and very loud call, insistent looking for her pup. And you have here a pup calling back at her. They're using both the vocal cues to first find them and then later on olfactory cues. And they're only going to accept their pups. And it's really quite cruel what they do to any pup that cheats. They really do get severely bitten, should they try. Occasionally also get pups that seem to have lost their mothers. We call them sneak sucklers. And again, if a mother should fall asleep and wake up and discover somebody else is taking her milk, she will also rebuff that pup. Because at the end of the day, she doesn't have enough to support two pups. Whoops. You notice here a pup, look at the back end compared to the front end, and we have the same phenomenon. So this is the birth coat, but again, look at how thick that fur is on the newborn when it's dry, and the tail end you can see is wet. The other thing I want you to point out is that is the color of the pup's first swimming pool. It literally is raw sewage. And many of the pups are in these areas where water's accumulated and are often splashing in and around it. They're lousy swimmers when they first start. They typically will go in the water when they're about 4 to 6 weeks of age. And the first time in the water, it looks more like dog paddling. It's just the most frantic, flopping, trying to keep their heads out of the water until they eventually learn they can put their heads underwater and pull themselves through the waters with their front flippers. They can, though, walk and swim soon after birth, but they're just lousy swimmers to begin with. It takes a while to get that skill. They're much better walkers in the beginning. The nursing period here I've shown as being 1, 2, or 3 years. When I first started studying sea lions, this would have been 1992, and you know, I'd ask the people who study sea lions their entire lives, when do they wean? They said, well, they're born in June, they usually wean around November. They wean in the wintertime, and the thinking was the reason for the decline is that they were starving during the time of weaning in the wintertime. So I sent one of my graduate students out to go observe these starving pups that were weaning, and of course we didn't see any animals weaning. Nobody's weaning in the wintertime. The only one who lost weight in the wintertime was him because the cabin that we built from this little island, the stove broke, everything froze, and just miserable. But the sea lions were perfectly happy. They were with their mother. Sent another team out in the springtime. Again, we saw no weaning. And it wasn't until we had the third team set out in the summertime that we saw the animals now starting to wean and consume fish as well. And that was sort of curious because we could also see before that time, in around January, February, animals, these pups were catching fish, and we see them playing with it. We never saw them swallow it, but they were catching fish. So we knew they had the abilities. But at the same time, we brought the first group of sea lion pups into the Vancouver Aquarium to effectively do studies to understand a lot of the energetics of the pups, how much food do they require, and test some of these theories about why they might be declining in the wild. And again, we only had the knowledge of the previous generation of biologists that they wean in November, December. So this first group, we brought them in I think it was July. We put them on the milk bottles, we grew them up, looked at our calendar, okay, it's December now, it's time to wean because that's what we thought they did in the wild. And we took them off, we gave them live fish in a tank, they were killing the fish, playing with them in their mouths, sucking it in, sucking it out, but they wouldn't swallow anything. They refused to eat any of the fish we gave them. We then debated we put them back onto milk, we can't do that, so then we force-fed them and putting fish in, and then they were sort of had this gag reflex that would prevent them from swallowing fish. They were now essentially trying to regurgitate it, fighting from swallowing it. And it was all so confusing until eventually, by massaging their necks, eventually got them to swallow, and over time were able to get them onto solid food. And so just to make sense, because what the biologist told us before is that this is when they're supposed to wean, and yet behaviorally they were fighting our desire to make them eat fish. Well, what we've now learned, both from sending people to the field, is that, and we've also watched some pups at the time in the field where they were pups that were starving and lost their mothers, trying to steal milk, and we go, well, that's strange. Why don't they just eat fish? Because we see the same age group catching fish and playing with them. And over a number of years, we figured out that what was happening is that for a sea lion, they have to grow so much that if they do not get lots of lipid, a high-fat diet, they're not going to grow, they're going to die. And so essentially their only option is it's either milk or death. But eating fish is not going to be an option unless you can be guaranteed to give them high oily fishes only. So both from doing the work here at the aquarium and trying to figure things out to watching the field and sending people out, we now know that the biologists had it wrong and that physiologically the animals can't wean that early, that they need to wean much later when they can now go on to food. Solid food. But the caveat in here is that, I mean, here we've got an animal, you can see it's no longer a pup. It's got its adult coat on, it's sleeping on its mom. It's now probably about a year and a half old, and it's still drinking milk. And again, we did another series of studies here trying to understand the energy requirements. And it turns out that in an ocean that's full of lean fish, such as the white flesh fish, this animal here would get full before it received enough calories to grow normally. And its option in that condition is to keep drinking milk. Mother keeps the pup longer. But in another system, as we currently have here in BC, the pup is not going to now eat lean fish. It's going to eat sardines and herring and sand lance. And under that scenario, mom can give birth every year. So that's why we see this plasticity, this huge range. And it seems to be they're weaning much later where they're declining because they're eating this low energy fish. So it's a long explanation, but it's just sort of part of piece putting these puzzles here back together. Some of the vital statistics, the females are sexually mature 3 to 4 years of age, whereas the males have got to wait much longer until they're not just sexually mature physically, but also socially mature as well, so about 7 to 8 years of age. But most of the ones that are actually breeding are going to be up closer to 10, 11, 12 years of age. Survival, females live longer than males, and by the time they're about 10 years old, there's about 3 females for every male still alive. So it really skewed sex ratio. Predators, they're afraid of killer whales. Sharks, increasing evidence that sharks are taking them as well, and of course humans. Sometimes they're shot around fishing gear, but historically, they were a big part of subsistence diets. Now, this picture here for killer whale, I should have put in another picture of where we've got shots of killer whales eating sea lions. Are these transient killer whales? So just in case somebody here is really into killer whales, you might recognize these as being residents. These ones here don't eat sea lions. These would be residents. So just in case, I know some of you already had that cetacean part of the course. So just to be sure that I'm not showing you a transient here. Other sources of mortality, disease, starvation. We find animals in the wild that have cancers. They're mammals. They suffer from some of the same things that humans suffer from as well. I mentioned how we have these two different populations that look the same, although the very subtle differences in their skull morphologies. And we think they were originally separated by glaciation. And we've got one of those populations, we call the western one that's declining and the eastern one here increasing. The way we know how many sea lions there is by counting them. They're typically counted by flying planes overhead and then taking a picture of what's there. And then somebody has to go and count all these dots. So that's how censuses are done, to figure out how many sea lions there are. And here you can see a very, very large rock with sea lions spread essentially all across it. You may also notice how stained some of the rock is. That's from the oil in the skin or in the fur of the animals, and it stains the rock. And if you're on these after a rain or if it's wet, it's just slippery as can be. You can hardly stand up. It's just covered in oil. And of course, just like with the harbor seals and doing a count, you need to figure out how many are at sea. And we've done that both from behavioral observations as well as putting on satellite tracking tags. So here's the final bit, is to try to bring all this together now and talk about some of these family characteristics to separate it. So again, a lot of text on slides, which Jonathan is going to be distributing. And I'm going to just try to compare so you get, again, another sense of some of the similarities and differences that may help you distinguish these different families. They're all mammals, so they share many of the same characteristics that we do, but they're highly adapted to living in the water. They must give birth on land or ice. They are unable to give birth in the water. The young will die if they give birth in the water. So those top ones there are three things that all pinnipeds, whether they be otariids, phocids, or otobenidae, share. But here's some ways they do differ: their morphology, their behavior, their relative numbers, and their distributions in the ocean. So we'll talk about each of these things. Starting first here with their morphology, the ears. So something else that people sometimes get confused by, and they're looking in the tank saying, is that a harbor seal or a sea lion? Well, the easiest way is to look at the head, and if you see little ear flaps, which group is that going to belong to? Sea lions are fur seals, so that's the otariids. The phocids, they just have two little holes, one on each side, but no ear flaps. Teats, again, your challenge is to try to count them, but there's a different number if you could turn the animal over, the females over. The skeleton, and at UBC, I've been on this sort of project building different skeletons of different species. We have a blue whale skeleton that maybe some of you have already seen, and in the building where my office is, we have Steller sea lions, and I'm hoping we're going to build an elephant seal as well. We now have its bones as well. But when you look at the skeleton, one of the most remarkable things is that on the neck region of the fur seals and sea lions, they got really thick vertebrae. And if you were to look on the skeleton of the phocids, relatively small at the neck, but at the tail end, really thick vertebrae. And that's, of course, because the muscles are being attached to these different points, because how does a phocid swim? With its hind flippers going back and forth. And so that's where the muscles are being attached when these big vertebrae, whereas the otariids, the muscle being attached to the neck, because they're essentially pulling themselves through like wings with their front flippers. Flippers. Maybe remember from some of the pictures which ones have hair on them, which ones don't. And so the flippers of the sea lions and fur seals, they're hairless. The hair may be up here, but then it's bare, almost like leather, whereas the flippers on the seals are all fur covered. They've all got, the true seals have got real claws, and the other ones just have residual, essentially fingernails. Swimming, the otariids are pulling with their front flippers. The others are pulling or pushing themselves through the water with their hind flippers. Behaviorally, we find that the phocids have got a number of different strategies, everything from being monogamous to being severely polygamous, but where the Otariids have got just a single strategy. You need one big male and can service a number of females. And for the Otobenids, the walruses, they're also polygamous, but we call that mobile lekking, because the ice is constantly moving, and the males can sort of display, but it's a very dynamic system that's not solid the way we have the land systems. Timing of mating, the Otariids was essentially a few days after birth, since right after that perinatal period. The Phocids is really waiting till towards the end of lactation or just after weaning, and the Otobenides are during lactation. Because, of course, for them, lactation goes on for 2 years. So that'd be a long time to wait or try to protect a female. Phocids tends to be a very brief period of lactation, really, really rich milk, very rapid growth of pups, whereas with the Otariids, it's much longer and slower growing animals. Walruses staying for about two years and fairly slow growth, just like with the Otariids. Molting, Phocids shorter, very rapid, and this sort of continuous gradual one for the Otariids over a 1 to 2 month period. Just think of all these fun facts you get to learn for your test. Abundance, so I said there were 33 species, and a rough estimate is that there's probably about 70 million pinnipeds in the world. And see when they break down though, about 90% of them are Phocids, and only about 10% of them are the Otariids and Otobenids. So, and you would have thought maybe, aren't they more evenly distributed? But most of the biomass out there, pinnipeds, are the true seals. And in decreasing order of abundance, we've got the crab-eater seals, and they live where, anybody know? Not in Canada, we've established that. Antarctica. They're gonna be down in the Antarctic. Ring seals that we can claim some ownership to, harp seals, and harp seal numbers are, since they've stopped the white coat hunt, their population is growing quite rapidly. And number four in here is the northern fur seals, coming mostly out of the Bering Sea and out of Russia. Their distribution, this is also an interesting comparison. The Phocids, which make about 90% of the animals, inhabit the widest range of habitats, and we've got some cases where they live in freshwater lakes. There's the Lake Baikal seal in Russia. In Canada, we have a harbor seal called the Lac des Loups Marins, which is sort of the sea wolf, or the lake wolf that's living in some of the freshwater lakes in Quebec. It's considered to be a subspecies of harbor seals. But we don't find any of the seals in the tropics except the monk seal, which is in the Mediterranean Sea. You might not call that tropics. Used to be in the Caribbean, is now extinct from there, and a third species in Hawaii that is struggling to hang on. The Otariids only inhabit the marine environment, but they're not in the extreme polar ones. They're more in the temperate areas, and they don't use ice, and most of these fur seals are in the southern hemisphere. Some parts of the world don't have any pinnipeds, so we don't find really any in a lot of Asia. You can find some around Japan, a little bit in Korea, a little bit in China, some of the largest seals, but none in India, and in big parts of the ocean we don't find any pinnipeds at all. There's also fewer species in the Antarctic than in the Arctic, but the numbers are much higher in the Antarctic. So we have those crab-eater seals in the Antarctic, for example. So numbers are higher, but fewer species, more diversity in the Arctic. We've talked about breeding systems, about, am I going in the direction? The timing of mating, the differences between the different species, the difference in lactation period. I feel I'm going through some of the same slides. So those are some of the very brief differences here between, and similarities between these three families. So finally then, we've been through species in Canada, the different pinniped families. We've touched on the life cycles, the similarities, the basic way they get through life living in the ocean. We've talked about some case histories, the harbor seals and Steller sea lions. So hopefully you have a better understanding of what their lives are like when you do see them at different times of the year. And finally, I've done a very quick comparison here of these differences in families in terms of abundances, distributions, locations in the world. So I want to leave you with one final bit, a little video clip that was taken of the open water site that may tell you a little bit more about some of the things that inspire us to study pinnipeds.
So UBC is located right on the water, and we have our site in Port Moody near UBC that's also located right on the water. Our lab is a floating lab, and we can go out and work with these animals in their natural environment. I actually am working directly with these huge, incredible animals, and there's not very many jobs out there where you get to work directly with animals that are this well-trained and this intelligent, and it's just, I think it's just something that's really unique. Steller sea lions are disappearing in Alaska, and we're trying to figure out why. So these sea lions that we have here are really trying to kind of the key to helping us figure out what's going on in the wild. Sea lions can really help with the big picture and ensure that another species doesn't disappear, because there's been a lot of species that have disappeared in my lifetime, and that's not something that I like to see, and I think that this is something hands-on that I can actually do to help.
Something new about pinnipeds you didn't know before, and thank you very much.
Okay, so we're going to go ahead and open up for some questions. So if you'd like to ask a question, feel free to raise your hand. And Andrew, you can call on them, and I'll head over there.
Did you want to put the mic to them?
Yep.
We got a really tall hand coming right up.
Hi, I was wondering, how did you go about finding that 30 to 60% of a given population will come to a haul out? How did you reach that percentage?
It's basically done by counting up the animals, both everything from aerial surveys, where you would count them at the major haul outs and the rookery sites, and then just looking at the average over time, as well as a number of these sites we've now put on satellite tracking tags, and from that we've got information about how long the trips are, when they're on land, when they're in the water. And we've also had students with binoculars recording movements of animals and keeping track of them. So it's putting all those pieces together that we can then understand at any given time what proportion is likely on land. So it's just a lot of observations and analysis of numbers.
Inevitably, that's what happens. Yeah. Questions go back and forth.
So are manatees related to pinnipeds at all?
Are they... No, the manatees are certainly not pinnipeds. we're dealing with a whole different group there over on the cetacean side of the envelope. But no, not pinnipeds. It's no fur. And that's another characteristic all these animals have is fur or hair of some sort on it. Even the walrus has got some residual hair on it.
Okay, well, I don't see any online questions for tonight, so we'll keep a look online to see if anyone posts any questions later, and we can answer those as they come. Thank you very much for coming tonight. Our next class, does anyone remember when it is? November 18th, our final class, our seabird class with Dr. Mark Kipfner, so make sure that you're here for that. And if you can't catch it here, you catch it online, of course. And then we'll be getting ready for the exam. So for anyone who would like to get a certificate for the course, we'll put together an exam. It'll be administered online, so we'll send you a link. You'll take the exam. It's open note, open book, open internet. So you can take as much time as you want with it, and then we'll have a date when you have to send it in by, and you'll need to take it all at once. And then on December 2nd, we'll have a nice little celebration here where we'll pass out some certificates and have a special presentation as well. If you have any questions about the course, I'm here. I would like to go ahead and say thank you very much to Dr. Andrew Trites. I know that your time is very valuable, and you may take some special time for this. So thank you very much for coming.
Thank you. And if anybody would like to come down and ask a question without the mic being turned on, I'd be happy to tell you more about this or other things.
All right, thank you. Good night.